The General by Robert Muchamore, read by Simon Scardifield. Chapter 1. Demo. The anarchist organisation known as Street Action Group, SAG, first came to light in summer 2003 when its leader Chris Bradford hijacked the rostrum at an anti-Iraq war demonstration in London's Hyde Park. Bradford urged a peaceful crowd to attack police officers before setting light to straw-filled effigies of Prime Minister Tony Blair and US President George W. Bush. By 2006, SAG had built a cult following and was strong enough to begin staging its own anti-government protests. These culminated in July with the Summer Mayhem march through central Birmingham. Dozens of cars were vandalised, windows were broken, more than 30 protesters were arrested, and a police officer was stabbed. In the months that followed, prison sentences were handed down to several senior SAG members involved in the rioting. Heavy police presence wherever SAG planned to appear made staging violent protests increasingly difficult. Chris Bradford became bitter at what he called state oppression, and an MI5 agent sent to infiltrate SAG made a shocking discovery. Bradford was trying to acquire guns and bomb-making equipment in order to transform SAG into a terrorist organisation. Excerpt from a Cherub mission briefing for James Adams, October 2007. It was December 21st, the last Friday before Christmas. The sky was purple and strings of lights dangled between Victorian lampposts on the pedestrianised London street. The pubs around Covent Garden tube station were crammed and office workers huddled in doorways smoking cigarettes. Teens gawped into shops well out of their price range, and the body shop was full of miserable-looking men buying last-minute gifts. Shoppers and drinkers ignored a rectangular pen made from metal crowd barriers as they shuffled past, though some noted the irony that 24 police officers in fluorescent jackets lined up to face 13 protesters inside the barriers. James Adams was one of the 13. 16 years old, he was dressed in a bulky army surplus jacket and 24-hole Doc Martin boots. His hair was shaved down to a number one on the sides, and a shaggy, green-tinted mohican ran from his forehead down to the collar of his jacket. He banged his gloved hands together to fight the cold as cops gave him stern looks. Chris Bradford stood 3 metres away. Well-built, Bradford had scruffy ginger hair, a baggy hoodie worn with the fluffy lining on the outside, and two cameras filming him. One was held by a cop who walked the perimeter with a titchy camcorder. The other was a more impressive beast. It sat on the shoulder of a BBC cameraman, and a lamp mounted on top shone its light in Bradford's face. "So, Mr. Bradford," BBC correspondent Simon Jett said. He had a silk scarf tucked into his overcoat and a microphone in hand. "Today's turnout must be a disappointment. Many people are saying that the Street Action Group is on its last legs." Bradford's green eyes bulged and his shovel-sized hands shifted towards the correspondent's lapels. "Who's been saying that?" he growled. "Give me names and addresses. It's always certain sources, but who are they? I'll tell you who. It's people who are running scared of us." Jet was delighted. Bradford's combo of slight menace and fruit and veg set a Cockney accent always made good TV. "So how many protesters were you expecting to see here today?" Bradford snatched a glance at his watch and bared his teeth. "Trouble is, most of our crew are still in bed 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I guess I set the kick-off time a little too early." Jet nodded with fake sincerity. "You sound like you're taking this lightly, but you must feel that the wind has been taken out of SAG's sails, especially when you compare the turnout here with 1,000-plus people on the streets of Birmingham last summer." Bradford battered the plastic hood over the camera lens. "You wait and see, Mr. BBC," he snarled, sticking his face right up to the camera. "Inequality breeds hatred. There's more poverty and inequality in Britain today than ever before. If you're sitting at home in your nice house watching the likes of me on your 32-inch LCD, you might not see revolution rising up from the streets. But you mark my words, we're coming to get you." Jack could barely contain his smile. "Do you have a time scale? When can we expect this revolution?" "Next month, next year, who knows?" Bradford shrugged. "Things will change radically before the end of this decade, but if you only watch the biased rubbish the BBC churns out, the first you'll know it is when my boys kick your front door down." The correspondent nodded. "Chris Bradford, thank you very much for talking to me." "Cram it," Bradford sneered as the cameraman turned off the light and moved away to the big camera off his shoulder. Bradford refused Jet's offer of a handshake and skulked towards a lonely-looking woman on the opposite side of the pen. James overheard Jet telling his cameraman to take some footage from outside of the pen before they left. The policeman, lifting up the barriers to let the BBC crew out, asked when the story was likely to be on the news. "Don't hold your breath," Jet said drearily. "I'm down here in case something kicks off, but I told my editor before I left. SAG is yesterday's news." "Hope so," the policeman said. "That officer up in Bram lost a lot of blood. She was lucky not to be killed." Jet nodded sympathetically. "You take care of yourself, officer. Have a good Christmas." "You too," the officer smiled. As the cameraman filmed the barriers and lines of police, James raised the hood of his jacket and pulled the drawstring tight so that it covered most of his face. Cherub agents are trained to keep away from the media, and he gained further anonymity by taking out his mobile and staring down at the screen, typing a message to his girlfriend, Anna. "Hope you're feeling better. Text me. I'm a lonely boy." James pressed send and regretted it straight away. Dana hadn't replied to his last message, and "I'm lonely" made him sound weak. He couldn't work out what he'd done to piss her off, but she'd been acting weird for days. Two metal barriers were lifted away, opening up one end of the steel pen. The petite inspector in charge of crowd control bawled out, "It's 3:30, people, time to march on Downing Street!" The inspector knew she'd been heard, but the protesters ignored her. She grabbed a megaphone from a colleague before repeating herself. "This demonstration was scheduled for 3:15, she blared. "You've already been allowed an extra 15 minutes for assembly. Anyone not leaving the assembly point now will be arrested for a breach of the peace. Now move it!" Bradford stepped towards the officer and glanced at his watch. A lone press photographer snapped a photo as the big man faced the squat officer with a fluorescent jacket and megaphone. "Come on, sweetheart," Bradford said, turning on the charm and tapping the face of his watch. "We're waiting for a few more chaps to arrive. I've sent my man up to the station and the underground trains must be delayed or something." "You've had your time," the inspector said, shaking her head resolutely. "My men want to get home, so you can march, you can disperse peacefully, or you can take a ride in the back of a police van. What you can't do is waste any more of our time." Bradford spat on the pavement before turning towards his pathetic gathering. "You heard the nice lady. Let's roll, people." The photographer's flash popped as 13 protesters filed out of the pen with fluorescent police jackets surrounding them. The cops exchanged grins, amused by SAG's pathetic showing. Shoppers watched curiously as the march filed past and kids gawped as if it was a continuation of the street entertainment and human statues in the covered market 100 metres away. As the police led the protesters briskly over the cobbles around Covent Garden Market, James began eyeballing clumps of people in the uniform of rebellion, a mixture of punk, goth and army surplus similar to his own. Some joined the back of the march, quickly doubling its strength, while others tracked its progress from a distance. Bradford sidled up to the inspector as they turned out of the market and onto a side road leading downhill towards the Strand, a broad avenue of shops, theatres and hotels less than 50 metres from the north bank of the River Thames. James was near the head of the march, and Bradford gave him a wink as 2 dozen youths dressed in sportswear emerged from a side street. "Looks like someone turned up after all," Bradford said to the inspector. "Someone must have written the wrong address on our invitation cards." The inspector didn't give Bradford the satisfaction of an answer, but James could tell she was on edge. She grabbed her radio and ordered backup as she realised that the protesters had made a mockery of the police's attempt to assemble all the demonstrators in one place. "SAG!" Bradford shouted, punching his fist in the air as the tracksuits and trainers merged with the dreadlocks and donkey jackets of SAG activists. "SAG!" the crowd of close to 100 chanted back. James's heart sped as a fellow protester caught the heel of his boot. "Sorry, mate." The crowd was tight and the cops now had bodies swarming around them. SAG had assembled the same toxic combination of hardcore anarchists and local youths looking for aggro that had kicked off the riot in Birmingham 17 months earlier. "Oggy, oggy, oggy!" Bradford shouted. "SAG, SAG, SAG!" the crowd shouted back. Another 50 marchers had joined the fray by the time James stepped onto the Strand and turned right. A huge drum was booming across the street and the shaven-headed drummer was leading a crowd of protesters out of an alleyway that ran up from the riverbank. The cop nearest to James heard spit running down his back. His baton was drawn, but the officers were afraid to break formation and lash out because they were heavily outnumbered. An amplified chant went up through the police megaphone. "We've just nicked your megaphone, doo-dah, doo-dah. We've just nicked your megaphone, doo-dah, doo-dah, day." Everyone laughed as the drummer and his crew cut through snarled traffic and moved to the front of the march, but the next chant had a nastier edge. "Let's stab all the coppers, doo-dah, doo-dah. Let's stab all the coppers, doo-dah, doo-dah, day." A vast roar blew up as James glanced around and saw that the cops had changed tactics and dropped behind the protesters. Sirens wailed in the surrounding roads as the march merged with another large group of SAG sympathisers pouring out of a bendy bus. There were more protesters than pavement, and bodies spilled into the road and mingled with the crawling traffic. Horns blared, and an impatient cab driver lost his door mirror and got his side window kicked in. A gap between the buses enabled James to see across the street where more protesters were coming up from the riverbank as the front of the march headed for Trafalgar Square. James had lost track of Chris Bradford and all the other SAG members he'd got to know over the last 7 weeks. He felt disorientated and was surrounded by a bunch of thuggish lads not much older than himself. They cheered, chanted, and egged each other on as the BBC cameraman balanced precariously on a concrete bollard, trying to film the chanting crowd from a high vantage point. "Told you it's worth coming down here," the lad next to James grinned, swigging from a can of beer as more glass smashed in the distance. "Bloody hell," his mate laughed. "That was a big one. Someone's done a shop." His friends nodded. "It's kicking off, man," one said, before another chant of "sag, sag, sag" ripped through the crowd. Less than 5 metres from James, two goth girls, who looked like the last people on earth to start a riot, pulled the metal liner out of a litter bin and hurled it through the front window of a sandwich bar. The crowd started clapping and a shout of "down with sandwiches" went through the stolen megaphone. The action of the two women embarrassed several testosterone-fuelled males into action. 4 more shop windows caved within seconds, and a man in a flash suit was dragged out of the back of a taxi and given a slap before being relieved of a wallet and a Rolex. James couldn't see over the crowd, but could hear hundreds of triumphant voices and the crunch of broken glass under his boot. Things were about to kick off, big time. Chapter 2. Twinkle. "Will you all stop jabbering and shut the hell up?" Lauren Adams yelled as the 13-year-old wrapped her hands over her ears. She was in her 8th-floor room on Cherub campus. Her bed had been tipped on its side to make space for the maps and diagrams spread across the carpet, and she sat studying them with 6 fellow Cherub agents. Her boyfriend Rat, her best friend Bethany, Bethany's 11-year-old brother Jake, Rat's best friend Andy Lagan, and 2 11-year-old Cherubs she barely knew called Ronan Walsh and Kevin Sumner. "If we're going to get picked to go to Las Vegas next month, we've got to get our plan straight and pull off this security test," Lauren continued firmly. "The ATCC is a new facility with state-of-the-art security. We've got to get into the heart of the building and cause damage in the main control room." Kevin was the smallest kid in the room and he looked at the maps nervously. "Which bit is the ATCC?
"The whole building, doofus," Jake Parker sighed noisily. "ATCC, Air Traffic Control Center."
"Oh," Kevin said. "I thought it was one of the alarm thingies." Bethany cuffed her brother Jake round the head.
"Don't bite Kevin's head off, he's only little."
Jake gave his sister the finger.
"He's less than a year younger than me, dog breath."
Rat sighed.
"Don't start fighting again, you two. Christ, what's that stink?"
They all turned towards Ronan. He was a stocky lad, mad on rugby and combat training, but less keen on showering afterwards. He'd just pulled off one of his muddy boots.
"Put it back on," Bethany gasped as she wafted her hand. "How long have you been wearing those socks?"
"My eyes are watering,"
Andy complained.
"Only about a week,"
Ronan said as he buried his nose between his toes and took a long sniff.
"Don't," Bethany yelled, "dirty animal."
"It's harmless," Ronan grinned as he swung his foot towards Bethany. "It's just my natural bodily juices." A couple of the lads laughed, but Lauren stepped over the maps and loomed above Ronan.
"If you don't put that boot back on, me and Bethany will drag you into the bathroom, strip you butt naked and scrub you with my toilet brush."
"Kinky,"
Andy laughed. "Stripped and scrubbed by 2 hot chicks?"
"2 repugnant walruses, more like," Jake said.
But Lauren shot the lads' evil eyes and they both shut up. Ronan reluctantly pulled his boot back on, and even though it was freezing outside, Bethany got up and flung open the balcony doors to clear the air. Lauren went back to squatting in front of the maps before speaking again. "I've got a good reputation and my black shirt," she said, stretching out her T-shirt to emphasise the point. "It won't make much difference to me if we mess this up, but we need to pull it off if you 3 younger lads want a sniff of some decent missions any time soon. So you guys choose. Screw around or calm down and start taking this plan seriously." Kevin, Ronan and Jake didn't like admitting that Lauren was right, but she glowered until they all nodded.
"Okay," Lauren said. "I'm the only black shirt here, so I'm making myself chairwoman. Any objections?"
Lauren half expected a mutiny, but they all knew someone had to take charge if their plan was going to work. Rat raised his hand and waited for Lauren's nod before he spoke.
"Here's where I see the problem with our plan right now," he said. "Bethany and Lauren do their bit at the front of the air traffic control centre, but me, Andy and the 3 little dudes are going to end up at the back facing 6 adult security guards with no weapons."
"We need guns,"
Jake blurted.
"Tranquilizer darts or stun guns at the least."
"Why don't you read the mission briefing?"
Lauren sighed.
"Our job is to test the security arrangements put in place by the private company at the new ATCC. If the government wanted people with balaclavas and machine guns, they'd have sent in the army. We've got to dress and act like ordinary kids on a pre-Christmas rampage. We can use our mobiles, but no walkie-talkies. We can't take listening devices, explosives, lock guns, or anything else that your average 13-year-old doesn't carry in the pocket of his hoodie."
Bethany raised her hand and waved her mission briefing in the air.
"But Lauren, it does also say that security guards are backed up by a team of military police."
"With guns,"
Jake added. "Read it properly," Lauren said.
to rapid response teams stationed on an RAF base 8 kilometres away, as long as we don't give the regular security team at the ATCC time to sound the alarm, we'll only be up against private security guards with batons and pepper spray.
If only we knew exactly who these guards are, Bethany said.
I mean, it could be anything from doddery little old men to retired special forces.
Laurent shrugged.
When that control centre opens in the new year, it's going to be in charge of every civilian and military flight from the Midlands right the way up to the Scottish Highlands. Planes could drop out of the sky if it was blown up.
Ronan nodded solemnly. So, unless security has been set up by total idiots, we won't be facing a team of Boy Scouts.
Why don't we go over to Dennis King in mission preparation and say that we need more information on the security team? Andy asked.
Lauren shook her head. Security tests like this one are part mission, part training exercise. King might give us more information if we ask, but we're supposed to devise our plan based on what they've given us. We'd get marked down in our assessment for sure.
I know,
Rat yelped triumphantly as he smacked his fist into his palm.
Slingshots.
What about them? Lauren asked.
Kids carry slingshots, Rat explained. When I lived at the Ark in Australia, I was always bored. One of the few toys I had was a slingshot. I used to fit it with rocks, pop out of a tunnel or a manhole, aim it at someone's head and dive for cover before they knew what had hit him. I caused at least a dozen concussions before Georgie caught me and had my butt paddled.
Sounds like a plan, Lauren smiled before Jake butted in.
I'm a good aim with a slingshot. We used to massacre squirrels with them over the back of the campus.
Lauren didn't like Jake, and as an animal lover and vegetarian, she was even less impressed than usual.
Excuse me, she said ferociously. What have campus squirrels ever done to you?
Not recently, Jake squirmed. I'm talking about when I was a little red shirt, camping out in tents in the summer.
Boys, Bethany said, shaking her head.
They all seem to go through a stage where all they want to do is kill stuff or set fire to it.
Rat tutted. It's completely sexist, Bethany. If I went around making generalisations like that about girls, you'd...
Ronan spoke at the same time as Rat.
I love setting fire to stuff.
All right, Lauren interrupted, clapping her hands together. Let's focus on the security test, shall we?
There are definitely slingshots downstairs in the weapons storeroom, and if you think they'll help our cause, go and get some by all means.
It's been a while since I fired a slingshot, Rat said, glancing at his watch. We've got a couple of hours before we leave, so I wouldn't mind getting a bit of practice in.
Jake smirked. We could shoot up the ducks on the lake. You're not funny, Jake, Lauren said. If I see you or anyone else hurting animals on campus, I'll pick you up and body slam you so hard that you'll piss blood for a month.
Empty coke cans make good targets, Kevin said, trying to be constructive.
Jake nodded.
Especially if you paint squirrels on them.
All right, Lauren nodded, gritting her teeth and fighting the urge to jump on top of Jake and beat the crap out of him.
You boys can go off and play with the slingshots, but before you do, I reckon we should go through the whole plan one last time from the top. I want all of you to know your jobs off by heart. Bethany, why don't you start?
Chapter 3. Surge. After the Birmingham demo had turned violent the previous year, Chris Bradford had found the police blocking every move the street action group made. 100 demonstrators would be met by 200 cops. Bigger SAG events would be outlawed by local councils, and anyone defying the ban found train stations closed, roads barricaded, and lines of police eager to arrest anyone who stepped out of line. These tough police tactics had crushed dozens of strikes and anti-government groups since they were first used during the miners' strike in the mid-1980s. To get around them, Chris Bradford had created the impression that SAG was imploding by staging ever smaller actions that drew tiny crowds and an ever smaller number of police officers to keep them in line. Once the police guard was down, Bradford organised the most ambitious anti-government SAG demo ever, and Christmas was the perfect time to pull it off. If you want mayhem on the streets, you need lots of bored young men, and school and university holidays are the time to find them. The cops would be at full stretch dealing with drunken revellers, while at the same time lots of officers would be taking leave. Most importantly, the run-up to Christmas is a quiet time for newspapers and TV, so you're guaranteed top spot on the news if you pull off something spectacular. James Adams had successfully infiltrated SAG, and he knew Bradford's plan. He'd told his mission controller, John Jones, but John chose not to pass the information to the police. James was investigating the more serious possibility of SAG turning into a terrorist group, and Bradford would have suspected a mole inside his organisation if it emerged from Covent Garden Underground Station and discovered hundreds of cops waiting for him. It's a problem with all kinds of intelligence work. Agents go undercover and get information, but you can't make use of it without compromising their safety. James couldn't help wondering if they'd made the right decision as hundreds of protesters steamed down the Strand towards Trafalgar Square. The noise was deafening, and although James was nervous, he got a buzz from being part of such a powerful group. Missiles flew overhead, and glass was shattering on both sides of the street. Diners in festive hats screamed as a paving slab crashed through the window of a Japanese restaurant. Seconds later, the leaded glass frontage of a Georgian theatre was kicked in,
the box office was shattered and posters of the cast were ripped off the awnings and flung into the air. Office workers and shoppers sheltered in doorways. Shop staff rushed to lock doors as the throbbing chant of "sag, sag, sag" roared down the street. SAG had sympathisers in some of London's roughest neighbourhoods, and James was impressed that they'd pulled together a diverse crowd of activists and troublemakers without the cops getting wind. Chris Bradford said he'd be happy with 150 protesters, but the crowd was now three times that. They divided evenly between the pavements on opposite sides of the road, with the overflow wading between four lanes of gridlocked traffic. 2 minutes after they entered the Strand, the pavements ahead of the marchers were bare. Pedestrians were either locked inside shops or had cut up one of the many side streets to avoid the chanting mob. Most of those who didn't get out of the way in time were ignored, and a few homeless who sheltered in the area found protesters showering them with coins and wishing them Merry Christmas. It wasn't such a good day if you were a drunken office worker, returning from a liquid lunch in a pinstripe suit and expensive watch. While the majority of the crowd was happy to chant and trash property, one especially intimidating group of youths grabbed anyone who looked like they had a bit of money and ordered them to hand it over. "Sag, sag, sag," James chanted, repeatedly punching the air as the crowd jostled on all sides and broken glass crunched under his boots. He had to live up to his green Mohican and his role as a young anarchist, so he took an enthusiastic kick, ripping the door mirror off a chauffeur-driven Mercedes trapped in the traffic between two buses. He grabbed the mirror out of the gutter and looked around, but couldn't find anything to throw it at. A second later, James found himself bundling into the person in front. The crowd behind squashed up and stopped moving. Everyone was surprised, and the chanting died down as James leaned into the road to see what was going on. Charing Cross Railway Station was less than 50 metres ahead, and Nelson's Column was lit up in the distance, but flashing blue lights and a line of police cars stretched across the road ahead. "Nazis," spat a bloke who was practically breathing down James's neck. "How'd they get here so bloody fast?" James didn't speak, but he knew there was a flaw in Bradford's plan. One of London's largest police stations was less than 50 metres from the route of the planned march. When the superintendent in charge of the Charing Cross police station heard that the march was getting out of control, he'd ordered several vehicles to drive out of a basement garage and blockade the entire width of the Strand. Every officer inside the station, including plenty who hadn't been away from a desk in years, was ordered to kit up in full riot gear. More than 50 cops now stood behind the barricade, with some less mobile officers jogging out clumsily to join them. "Please disperse immediately," a tannoy inside one of the police cars blurted. "We're expecting more reinforcements shortly. You will be arrested and could face serious charges." After the announcement, the cops tried to psych the crowd out by drumming their batons on their plastic riot shields, and it seemed to work. There was an eerie stillness as the crowd sought direction. James watched hundreds of plumes of warm breath wafting up into the darkening sky. The police lights mingled with Christmas lights, and it felt like a break between hymns at an outdoor carol service. But menace hung in the air, and James noticed that some of the protesters on the edge of the crowd were filtering away into the side streets. As the number of people disappearing up the side streets grew, the mood deflated and it appeared the march was going to fizzle. But everything changed when an orange streak shot down from a third-story window and exploded into a ball of flame between two of the parked police cars. Beyond James's line of sight, several activists had forced a glass door and climbed a flight of steps into an office suite above the shops. They'd opened a window and thrown out a petrol bomb. As the crowd cheered and whistled, more bombs rained down, spewing burning petrol over the road and setting light to the police cars as the officers scrambled from their barricade in total panic. The big drum started banging again, and the whole crowd was jumping into the air and shouting at the top of its voice, "Sag, sag, sag." James thought he'd known everything about Bradford's plan, but he hadn't known about the petrol bombs, and the way they'd been expertly aimed at the police lines made it seem more like a planned operation than a spur-of-the-moment thing. "Sag, sag, sag." Anyone who wasn't shouting was whistling, and it made James's ears hurt. But even though the police officers had backed off, there was no way forward through the line of flaming cars. The man holding the stolen megaphone came to the rescue, giving the crowd their orders. "Trash the Savoy! Trash the Savoy!" "Bloody good idea," someone shouted as the mob turned on its heels and began heading back the way it had come, towards one of London's largest and fanciest hotels. James was much nearer the back of the mob than the front, and it was almost a minute before he was back on the move. "We just burned the coppers, doo-dah, doo-dah, we just burned the coppers, doo-dah-doo-dah-day." Amidst the chaos and the sound of more breaking glass, James felt his phone vibrating inside his pocket. There was too much noise to hold a conversation, so he was relieved to see a text from Dana. "Have you seen my green tracksuit top?" James was pleased to hear from his girl, but disappointed that she'd ignored his message about missing her. It was a struggle tapping out the reply, with bodies jostling on all sides, and one bloke almost knocked the phone from his hand. "I think I saw it under my bed," he replied. As James pocketed the phone, he bumped into the person in front and looked up. The noise of the crowd had dipped again, and he could hear the distinctive sound of cops whacking batons on their plastic riot shields. With police blocking the road ahead and a flaming barricade behind, James was just one of 300 heads that turned towards the side streets looking for a way out, but they'd all been blocked off by white cars with blue flashing lights. Back on campus, Rat, Andy, Jake, Kevin and Ronan were charging down the main staircase, heading from Lauren's 8th-floor room to the weapons storage cupboard on the ground floor. "Who the hell does Lauren Adams think she is?" Jake moaned as he swung round the end of a banister. "Stuck-up little troll." "You're talking about my girlfriend," Rat warned. Andy knew they had to work as a team and tried smoothing things over. "Lauren might be full of it, but she knows her stuff, Jake. She's got one of the best mission records of anyone on campus, and she's still only 13. Ronan giggled. "If she had massive jugs like Bethany, she'd be perfect." Andy and Rat both laughed. "I swear they get bigger every time I see her," Rat said. "You're talking about my sister," Jake said bitterly. "Give over, Jake," Andy said. "You two hate each other." "Ellie's in love with Bethany," Rat teased as Ronan jumped half a flight of stairs onto the 6th-floor landing, making a massive thud. "But he's too much of a shitter to ask her out." "You talk rubbish, Rat," Andy said aghast. "I said I liked her one time and you've been going on about it ever since." "Shitter," Rat repeated. By this time, they'd all reached the 6th-floor landing, but Kevin peeled off into the corridor. "Where are you going?" Rat asked. "We're all supposed to be going down for slingshot practice." "I don't want to get these muddy," Kevin explained as he looked down at his glowing white Nikes. "I'll nip to my room and change." Ronan shook his head. "Change your trainers? How much of a girl are you, Kevin?" "At least I don't stink of piss," Kevin yelled back. Ronan was halfway down to the 5th floor, but he spun round and squared up to Kevin. "Say that again, I'll stomp on your head." "Leave it out," Rat sighed. He was one of the strongest 13-year-olds on campus, so he had no problem pulling the two 11-year-olds apart. He shoved Kevin down the hallway towards his room before grabbing Ronan by his collar. "We're going to be stuck in a minibus for 2 hours on the way to the ATCC. If you smell like anything other than soap or deodorant, you're riding on the roof rack." "Yeah," Kevin smirked as he walked backwards down the hallway towards his room. "Take a bath, loser." "See you down in the weapons room, Kev," Rat said as Andy and Jake resumed the charge downstairs. Kevin's room was like all the others in the main building. Small sofa by the door, double bed, desk with a laptop near the window, wardrobes along the length of one wall, and a bathroom off to the side. But he was surprised to see a rusted toolbox in his bathroom doorway. Karen, the campus plumber, leaned out of the bathroom. She wore battered denim dungarees over a white Cherub shirt and held a toilet seat in her gloved hand. "Hello," she said warmly. "Just fitting your new toilet." All the toilets on campus were being replaced with water-saving units. It had been announced in morning assembly that Monday, but Kevin had forgotten all about it. "I'll be done in 10 minutes, but if you need to go, you can christen the one I just fitted across the hall." "No probs," Kevin nodded. He sat on the edge of his bed and leaned forward to grab an old pair of trainers from underneath. After lacing his shoes, Kevin wished the plumber a Merry Christmas before running back to the corridor. He reckoned it was a good idea to take a leak before heading out into the December cold to shoot slingshots, so he grabbed the handle of the door directly across the hallway and stepped into James Adams' bedroom.
Chapter 4. Blag. James ducked in fright as heat from the flames popped a tire on one of the burning cop cars. Sirens wailed in the surrounding streets while the crowd pushed and shoved. James was tall enough to breathe, but some of those lower down were getting crushed and starting to panic. "Please remain calm," a police tannoy announced. "You will be dispersed in an orderly fashion." 80 demonstrators had leaked up the side streets before the petrol bombs had gone off, leaving a rump of 300 protesters trapped between the police lines. 50 officers blocked the crowd into place at the eastern end of the Strand, and dozens more cut off side streets, but while the cops were outnumbered 5-1, none of the protesters fancied their chances against shields, helmets and extendable batons. A veteran protester standing close to James explained police tactics to his girlfriend.
"Bastards will keep us here for hours, letting us out 2 or 3 at a time. They'll take all our photos and details before letting us go."
"Sag, sag, sag," someone shouted, but the reply from the crowd was half-hearted, and people were being blinded by the spotlight on a police helicopter sweeping overhead. James suspected they were prowling for Chris Bradford and the other senior SAG members, but a lot of high-profile SAG members had been imprisoned after Birmingham, and those who remained on the outside had slipped away before the protest reached its peak. A bigger explosion ripped off behind James as the fuel tank of a police car exploded. On the side of the street away from the fire,
The police had rolled a couple of lightly damaged cars out of the blockade and begun marching through the gap to block the crowd from the rear. The cops drumming on their riot shields panicked the crowd into an even tighter formation, and a woman standing close to James screamed out that she couldn't breathe. The crush wasn't caused by a lack of space, but by the fact that none of the protesters wanted to be on the edge of the crowd when the police closed them down completely. They were huddling from police batons the same way emperor penguins huddle from the cold.
"I've got to get out," the woman screamed. "Let me out of here."
The crush seemed pointless to James, and unlike the slender female, he had the muscle to make headway through the crowd. As he pushed past bodies, he grabbed the panicking woman and put his arm around her back. "Calm down," James said firmly as they reached open space and found themselves in no man's land between the protesters and a line of riot shields 30 meters away. Across the street, the eastbound traffic that had been trapped between the two police lines was being allowed out one car at a time. As the girl, who looked like she was in her early 20s, rummaged inside her shoulder bag and grabbed an asthma inhaler, James took a bottle of water out of his backpack and offered her a drink.
"Thank you," she said, speaking with a heavy French accent before pausing to down some of the water. "I got so scared in there."
"No worries," James smiled. Once the traffic on one side of the road was clear, the crowd moved into the extra space and tensions eased as it dawned that the riot cops weren't going to charge in and start whacking people. James and his new friend backed up to a column between closed shutters in front of a jewellery store and electrical store.
"Smoke?"
the girl asked as she pulled a packet of 10 and a lighter out of her bag. James shook his head and laughed.
"Cigarettes and asthma. Nice combo."
But his smile vanished when he glanced at his watch. He was supposed to be covering Chris Bradford's back at a meeting on the other side of London in less than 3 hours' time. It was important for the mission, but James didn't have a hope of making it if the police were planning to disperse the protesters by releasing them two or three at a time over the space of several hours.
"I need to be somewhere else," James said.
The French girl smiled.
"If you have a plan, I'm all ears."
James studied her clothing for the first time. Her black stockings and expensive-looking striped coat didn't fit the mould of a SAG activist or an urban yob.
"How'd you find out about the demo?"
"I'm studying journalism," the girl explained. "I'm working 3 months at the local bureau of a Paris newspaper. I was at a party last night. I heard some guys talking about the possibility of trouble."
"Looking for a scoop," James said before smiling absent-mindedly. He usually paid attention to what pretty girls said, but his eyes had strayed towards the metal shutters at the front of the electrical store. Each shutter had metal clasps that were designed to be padlocked from the outside, but they'd been pulled down in a hurry, and he wondered if there was any way to lock them from the inside.
"Where are you going?"
the French girl asked as James moved 2 paces to his left and peered between the slats of the roll-down shutters. All the lights were on inside the store. There was a display area at either end of the shop's frontage, and in between them a recessed area behind which were 6 glass doors, all locked.
"There must be a way out of the back," James said.
He kept a wary eye on the line of policemen before squatting down, lifting the shutter quickly and ducking beneath it.
"Where are you going?"
the French girl asked.
"Don't stare," James said anxiously.
He stood up slowly in the recessed area between the shutters and the door. It was a relief to see that everyone had left the store except the manager, who stood at the rear playing Pro Evo Soccer on an Xbox. James stepped gingerly across the tiles and pushed each of the 6 glass doors, but wasn't surprised to find them locked. Cherubs are trained in lockpicking using a mechanical lock gun, but it wasn't something James carried routinely, so he'd have to rely on his multi-tool to get inside. A quick glance up towards the door handles provided some relief. The shop's main security was provided by tough padlocks on the shutters. The doors also had deadlocks, but as with the shutters, they were designed to be operated from the outside when the shop was closed up for the night. The 2 outer sets of doors were bolted from the inside, but the pair in the middle were designed to open electronically by swinging inwards. The current had been switched off, but there was no obvious physical barrier preventing them from being forced open. James would be able to force them open as long as he could get his fingers between the 2 doors. The French girl blew cigarette smoke through the shutters as James crouched low and prepared to try.
"Are you okay? Can you get inside?"
"Don't stare, for Christ's sake," James said irritably.
There were hundreds of protesters and dozens of cops nearby, and it was a minor miracle that he got this far without being spotted. He pushed the toe of his boot against the bottom of 1 door, opening a small gap into which he hoped to wedge his fingers, but they were too chunky. To get around this, James pushed the sawtooth blade of his multi-tool into the gap between the 2 halves of the electronic door, then used it as a lever until the gap was big enough to squeeze in 4 fingers of his right hand. The whole weight of the door pressed on his fingertips as he pulled, and he couldn't help making a noisy grunt. When the door had moved another centimetre, he was able to get the fingers of his other hand into the gap, but it only budged when he shifted his whole body weight backwards. The hydraulic pistons that usually operated the doors hissed in unison,
but James's sense of triumph only lasted for the half-second between the doors breaking open and the loud clattering sound as his fingers lost their grip and his entire body slammed the grill behind him. As James recovered his balance and stood up, the French girl clambered under the shutter. Fellow protesters who had heard the rattling shutter saw the whole thing. Inside the store, the manager had dropped the Xbox controller and vaulted over the cashier's counter where he pressed the emergency alarm button. "Get out of my store!" he shouted defiantly. Unfortunately, sounding the alarm was the worst move he could have made. A couple of protesters were already following the French girl under one shutter, but everyone heard the alarm, and the protesters were rejuvenated.
"Oggy, oggy, oggy!" someone shouted through a megaphone.
"Sag, sag, sag!" the protesters shouted back as the remaining shutters opened and a scrum formed around the automatic doors. Inside, James dragged the French girl by the arm and they ran together towards a door at the back of the shop.
"It's a storm!"
she shouted, her French accent thickening as panic set in. As James spun to exit, the manager blocked his path. If he'd known how much combat training James had done, he wouldn't have dared, and James effortlessly grabbed the squat salesman by his company tie and bundled him sideways into a rack of battery chargers and mains adapters. "Stay back or I'll hurt you properly," James ordered before setting off towards a fire exit sign on the opposite side of the store. They were no longer alone. More than 50 protesters had made it through the double doors and were now fighting over access to a single fire door at the back of the store. While most wanted to escape, others couldn't resist thousands of pounds worth of electrical equipment. Dozens more alarms were set off as laptops and DVD recorders got ripped off their display stands. The youths who had mugged several bystanders earlier on were standing behind the photography counter and stuffing boxed cameras and iPods into the biggest carrier bags they could find. Out on the Strand, the police at both ends had rushed in to stop the getaway, but this spooked some sections of the crowd who feared that the police would lash out when they got close. Others were emboldened. The formations of police drumming on riot shields had been intimidating, but the cops' lack of numbers was plain to see once the lines were broken. About 70 protesters made it into the electrical store before 6 officers with riot shields blocked it off, but none of them risked following the crazed mob inside. The remaining demonstrators divided between a charge through police lines towards the Savoy Hotel and a smaller breakaway group that forced its way past a pair of officers blocking one of the alleyways leading towards the river. Outnumbered and out of formation, the cops made the situation worse by lashing out with batons and swooping into the crowd to randomly arrest anyone they could get their hands on. Back inside the store, James and the French girl made it up through the crush around the fire door, down 3 steps and into a second, larger stockroom. Double doors at the back opened directly onto a narrow alleyway, but you had to fight through looters ripping off electrical goods to get there. James wouldn't be allowed to keep anything he stole on the mission, so he wasn't interested. But the French girl couldn't resist cutting between 2 racks of stock and grabbing a pair of small boxes.
"Toshiba laptop?" she beamed as she handed one to James. "Très cher, lightweight, ideal for journalists."
They exited nervously into fresh air in a single-lane road. There were dozens of looters heading off in either direction, but it was the kind of space that could easily be blocked off by a pair of police cars, so James grabbed his companion's skinny arm and began running at full pelt. After a 200-metre sprint, they found themselves at a Y-shaped junction with 2 wider roads, and despite there being no officers in sight, James was shocked by the distinctive blue lanterns hanging on the front of Charing Cross Police Station.
"This way," he gasped. "I'm so breathless," the girl protested.
By some miracle, a black cab hurtled around a corner and deposited a newspaper photographer onto the pavement less than 20 metres away. James harried the driver as he fiddled with some change.
"Take us to Islington," James said. "Caledonian Road."
"Keep your green air on, sonny," the taxi driver said. "I'm just writing this gentleman's receipt." James's heart leapt as he saw a police officer in riot gear staggering round a corner towards the station, but he was in no state to arrest anyone, limping badly and with a huge crack in one side of his helmet, like he'd been hit by a paving slab or something. As the photographer made a dash towards the scene of the rioting, James was horrified to see 3 huge looters in tracksuits and bling jewellery running towards the taxi.
"That's our cab, man!" they shouted.
The one leading the way held carrier bags stuffed with cameras, while his 2 mates had stacked one of the electrical store's trolleys with boxes containing PCs and laptops.
"I said that's our cab,"
the big man repeated, giving James a mean look as he grabbed him by his shoulder. James was pumped from all the action. He grabbed the hand and twisted the giant thumb until it dislocated. Meantime, the French girl had climbed into the taxi and was banging on the glass partition inside.
"Just drive me," she said. James
reached for the door. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.